Well, welcome everyone to this program sponsored by NYU School of Law and the Dwight D. Opperman Institute of Judicial Administration. I'm Oscar Chase. I'm one of the faculty directors of the IJA, as we call it. I'm really very honored and pleased and thrilled that we have a very distinguished panel here to discuss the cases that, as you know, have triggered a good deal of interest, concern, controversy among all of us who either study or practice litigation. And you should have in your materials, whether you got them online or you will have the bios of our distinguished panelists. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on the introductions they all deserve, but in the order in which they will speak, I will briefly introduce, first of all, on my far right, my colleague at NYU School of Law, Professor Eleanor Fox, who I'm sure many of you know is one of the outstanding antitrust scholars in the country, and indeed, given her study of competition law in Europe and Asia, I would say in the world. And Eleanor will start us off with some remarks from her perch as an antitrust specialist. And she'll be followed by the president of the IJA, Institute of Judicial Administration, Evan Chesler. Evan is an alumnus of NYU School of Law and is also a member of the Board of Trustees. And he is the, is it managing partner, the correct term?
Presiding
partner at the Cravath firm, and will give us the perspective of the litigator of big cases. Then to my far left, my colleague Arthur Miller, who is, as many of you know, one of the leading procedural scholars in the country, who, among other things, is the author and co-author of many great works, including the treatise on civil procedure, which, if you read it carefully, you will recall was cited at least 5 times by the Supreme Court in the Twombly case. And Arthur will perhaps give some thoughts from the point of view of the academic student of civil procedure. And then finally, we're very honored to have with us Judge John Koeltl from the Southern District of New York, who is well known for not only his outstanding work on the bench, but also himself a student of procedure. Judge Koeltl is in the process of organizing a major conference at Duke Law School on reforms of civil procedure rules in the light of ongoing problems of expense and delay, and I hope he'll say something about the big picture there when he comes. The program that we've planned is that each speaker will address us for about 15, no more than 15 minutes, and in turn, then perhaps some interchange among the panelists, and then some opportunity for questions and comments from the floor, and followed by an informal reception in the room. So with that, let me turn to Professor Fox.
Thank you very much, Oscar, and I'm really very honored to be here with this wonderful and distinguished panel. I think since my background is antitrust law, Oscar asked me to say a few words about Twombly, which is, after all, an antitrust case, and I'll say also a few words about Iqbal. I will first give a little history going back some years to show how Twombly fits into a trend in antitrust law and actually lots of other bodies of law, and talk about then the current landscape and what is happening in the shadow of Iqbal and Twombly, and then a few conclusions. So I would like to go back about 30 or 40 years ago, when it was very easy for plaintiffs to plead and stay in court. It was very hard for defendants to win on motions for summary judgment. It was relatively easy to get classes certified. In antitrust, it was very easy to prove a credible idea that almost any action was anti-competitive. And all of those things changed slowly, one by one. The cases especially since the 1980s, but even more so since the 1990s, the screws have turned. The courts have observed, and the Supreme Court has very much observed, actions were then brought by plaintiffs, often totally valid, but often also nuisance actions. It was very easy to get a good settlement on a nuisance action because those cases very easily got into court. The court in the antitrust field particularly invoked the word false positives, meaning that too many cases would get into court and get to trial, and the plaintiff might get a judgment when the action actually that was challenged of the defendant was really not anti-competitive at all. So the court began to react against these false positives one by one in many, many cases. Beginning in 1993 alone until Twombly, there were, I'm talking about now, the private antitrust cases that came before the Supreme Court. The cases that came before the Supreme Court were incidentally in that period all brought by private parties. They were all private actions. In every one of those cases, for 18 consecutive cases, and now there's actually a 19th, but 18 up to Twombly, the defendant won. The court cut back the law. Sometimes it was making it harder to prove a contract. Sometimes it was saying that courts should not intervene so much with conduct, which might indeed be pro-competitive. In 2004, there was a case called Trinco, an antitrust case. It was a telecommunications case. It was a monopolization case. And in the Trinco case, again, the defendant won, and won with a decision by the court that really very substantially cut back the Section 2 of the Sherman Act, which is monopolization, and gave, in its rhetoric, gave a framework for analyzing that was much more sympathetic to, well, just let the market work and don't allow antitrust intervention too liberally. This Trinco case was actually a very close predecessor of the Twombly case, both being telecoms cases, both arising from, in one part, very similar conduct. You have an incumbent telecommunications company. Suddenly, the market becomes competitive because new technology comes on board. Congress notes that it is now possible to compete in the local telecoms markets. It passes a law that actually invites in new competitors. But the incumbent, of course not liking the competition, does everything it can to keep the new competitor at bay. And the incumbent has the total unique access to something called the local loop, which anybody needs to compete in the area to receive the long distance call and to funnel it to its local destination. So in Trinco, the case was about whether the incumbent telephone company had manipulated the market and manipulated the extent to which it allowed these newcomers access to the local loop. And the court found that what the incumbent did was not an antitrust violation. Twombly was about some of the very same conduct, but now on a national scale, with the plaintiff saying, in each of these local markets, the incumbent has manipulated the market and made it very difficult for the newcomers to come in. And Twombly contained another allegation. The allegation was, and none of these incumbents are crossing over their own borders to compete in the neighboring territory, even though it looked like it would be a very lucrative thing to do, to just go across the border and compete. That was the plaintiff's allegation. That is what the court dismissed in Twombly, saying there is no good reason to believe that there was a conspiracy. Twombly's about a conspiracy. the court said, no good reason to believe that there was a conspiracy of all of these incumbent telephone companies that used to be monopolists to keep one another out of their markets. The court used the opportunity, of course, as you know, to tighten up the rules of pleading and changed the basic rule on pleading, saying that the plaintiff must at least plead the facts that make it plausible to infer, in Twombly it would be, a conspiracy among these telephone company once monopolists to stay out of one another's territory. And the court said in Twombly, there was not basis for a plausible inference that there was a conspiracy because the conduct could so easily be explained by natural motives that you would expect of all of these telephone incumbents. They didn't want the competition. They didn't like the competition. They grew up in an era of monopoly, and it would be so easy for them to just keep things as they were, not go into one another's territory and let competition break out, hold tight, and hope their neighbors would feel the same way and do the same thing. So the court said, therefore, the plaintiff has not nudged its case across the line sufficient for a plausible allegation of conspiracy. The case is written by Justice Souter, and I'll come back to Justice Souter in a minute. He says, I just want to read one other clause that he says, that the plausible grounds to infer an agreement does not impose a probability requirement at the pleading stage. It simply calls for enough fact to raise a reasonable expectation that discovery will reveal evidence of illegal agreement. So now we go on quickly and come to Iqbal. Obviously, Twombly is an antitrust case. People were wondering whether Twombly would be extended to the rest of law, not just antitrust. Iqbal extends Twombly to the rest of law, to all of pleading, and goes farther, because Iqbal is the case of an individual who was detained and imprisoned, a Muslim man, who brings a case against many U.S. officials, including Ashcroft, alleging that the officials knew and condoned that Muslim men were being seized and detained and imprisoned and treated harshly in the prisons solely because of their race and ethnicity and not because they were threats to terrorism. And the court dismissed the case on the pleadings, holding either that the claim was not plausible or that the allegations were simply too conclusory, that plaintiff simply pleaded what the plaintiff thought it had to plead in conclusory terms to stay in court, and that wasn't enough. Interestingly, in Iqbal, the dissenting justice who wrote the dissenting opinion is Souter, who said, that's not what we meant. We did not mean that in Twombly that the court should be able to examine the truth of the facts alleged. We simply meant that the case had to be, the pleadings had to be plausible. So now I just want to say a word about what is happening today. And for my part, I want to say a little bit about what is happening today on the antitrust side. Today, Twombly has changed the landscape. In almost every antitrust case, there will be a Twombly motion. If you're a defense lawyer and you don't make a Twombly motion, well, you're not representing your client properly. Many of the motions are granted. Some are not. There was a very strong trend of granting those motions in many cases where a number of people would say, the allegations alleged a plausible claim. But of course, other courts thought otherwise. For example, there's a famous airline agent case, a travel agent case, about 5 years ago, in which all of the airlines, in virtually lockstep, cut back the percentages of commissions that they would give to the travel agents, and did so in five successive steps, in lockstep, down to zero, at about the same time, and the court threw the case out and said, well, it just wasn't plausible that there was a conspiracy, because the action could have represented simply acting, each one acting in its own interest and sometimes relying on each other. You could have a leadership case where one airline sees another airline's announcement and follows the leader. Following the leader is not a conspiracy and is not illegal. So the case was thrown out. A very important case came down 2 months ago, and that is the Star against Sony, which is about the major record producers who were alleged to have fixed the price of digital music. This is a case in the Second Circuit. And in this case, some people look at it now as a turn of the tide. The plaintiff had pleaded with rather great specificity many points, and I'll just mention one that the court thought led to plausibility. And the one I want to mention is the prices were thought to be, the prices charged by the majors were thought to be exploitatively high. The terms were thought to be exploitative. There were factual allegations about this. And just as their costs were going way down, they raised the prices of the wholesale prices of the digital music almost in lockstep, and the court, reversing the district court, kept the case in. I won't say more about it now. Details of it are very interesting. I'll just say a few words about a few conclusions. First of all, in my view, the landscape has changed quite a lot, and perhaps I should have mentioned this at the outset, but the costs of discovery was something that concerned the Supreme Court a huge amount. The costs and burdens of discovery and the fact that the discovery might be taken in cases that were meritless. So much of that, the tables have turned on that. The defendants are winning a lot of the motions. Number two, I wanted to say, I think in this area, there are two ambiguities of words that are ambiguous in both Twombly and Iqbal. And the definitions need to be worked out because of the ambiguity of two words. One is plausible and one is inference. And judges take them to mean two different things along the line of a continuum. And until the meaning of those words become clearer, there will be very disparate judgments, decisions of the court. And I think I will simply close by saying a word about definitions. The Supreme Court said, as I mentioned, that in Twombly, because the plaintiffs have not nudged their claim across the line from conceivable to plausible, their complaint must be dismissed. And so my point here is, first of all, there is no line. If you're talking about what is plausible, what plausibly might be a conspiracy, it is not a line, it is a continuum, it is more or less likelihood. The Supreme Court has said it does not require proof of probability, so you're short of probability. And the question is, what is plausible? So I wanted to read you a couple of definitions that I took off the web that show the great room for difference here in terms of that continuum, that plausible means seemingly or apparently valid, credible, apparently trustworthy or believable, with some stress on apparently. So we don't know how plausible. But more interesting is there a plausible inference of conspiracy? Even more interesting, what does inference mean? Does it mean that you must infer as a matter of reasonable probability, or is it something short, and how short? So here, Infer means to derive a conclusion from facts or premises, such as we see smoke and therefore infer fire. Number two, a guess or surmise. Your letter allows me to infer that you are as well as ever, said Oliver Wendell Holmes. And one more line. This one from Shakespeare. This is a third definition of infer, meaning to indicate. This doth infer the zeal I had to see him. Shakespeare. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eleanor, for getting us off to such a good start. And now I'll turn the podium over to Mr. Chesler.
Thank you, Oscar. So let me, my intent is to spend a few minutes talking about the perspective of these cases from the vantage point of a litigator, trial lawyer, large, I guess what are generally called complex cases. Let me begin by saying that I from time to time represent plaintiffs, although mostly defendants, but from time to time plaintiffs. So my views about these pleading standards are not really wedded to a defense lawyer's view, because I have to confront those same standards and requirements when I am drafting the complaint as opposed to answering the complaint. And frankly, this is a position that perhaps some others here will disagree with. I don't see these cases as a revolutionary change in the standards. In my experience, district court judges have applied a kind of Lewis Powell view of complaints. I know a complaint that ought to be dismissed when I see it, and I know one that ought to survive a Rule 12 motion when I see it. And I at least have always thought that notice pleading did not mean simply citing the relevant statutes, reciting the elements of the offense, and then praying for relief. I thought it meant what Rule 12 says, which is that the question is whether a claim that is sufficient to obtain relief has been stated, and that requires something more, which is when I first read the Twombly case, I thought Justice Souter was saying. The something more in his formulation, in the court's formulation, were sufficient facts to raise a plausible claim. And I think if you flip it over and ask whether courts should permit implausible claims to proceed through discovery and to trial, it doesn't seem like such a revolutionary standard. I think most people would agree that implausible claims are not worthy of spending much time on. So I think that this is really about calibrating what is sufficient under Rule 12 to withstand a motion. And I think there are some basic principles about litigation that apply here. And the first is that it shouldn't be about hiding the ball. I think the federal rules are really devoted to the proposition that you have an obligation to inform the defendant of what your claims are, and the defendant has an obligation to let you know what its defenses are, and it shouldn't be about hiding the ball. Now, this doesn't mean, in my view at least, that one is required to disclose your litigation strategy, the outlines you've prepared for the direct testimony of your witnesses, your cross-examination outlines. Obviously, that's not what this involves, and those are properly reserved to trial. But it certainly, in my view, should mean that at the pleading stage, there is an obligation to notify one another of what the material facts are that support your claim for relief. And I believe that's what the short statement, the brief statement of Rule 8 was always intended to require, and what Rule 12 requires in order to withstand a motion to dismiss. Now, The costs of discovery, which the court was so focused on in the Twombly case, certainly from my vantage point representing companies, and frankly representing companies that most would agree can afford to participate in litigation, the expense has nevertheless become a crushing expense. And I think that is for several reasons. First, I have seen over the course of my career as a practicing lawyer, a significant change in what the perceived goal of discovery is. I think it has moved from the goal of avoiding surprise, to the goal of discovering every conceivable fact that you might want to prove at trial. Those are fundamentally different goals. And I have seen, from my own experience, a transition from the former to the latter over the course of time. And I believe that that's had a fundamental impact on the cost of discovery. Second, I've seen the rise of the use of discovery as an end in and of itself. And more in my experience, there is litigation over what happens in discovery as a kind of sideshow to litigation over the ultimate merits of the case. And there are all sorts of reasons, but frankly, getting bogged down in a land war in Asia over discovery is a way to wear parties down, to engage in a kind of process of attrition so that you never ultimately have to litigate the merits. It's a way of establishing or undermining credibility, lawyers believe, many lawyers believe, in the eyes of the court by demonstrating that the other side has acted inappropriately in discovery, by hiding things, by not disclosing what they're obligated to disclose. So litigation of the discovery process becomes useful in and of itself. And in a world in which, frankly, not that many civil cases go to trial, and therefore scoring advantage in what some of my colleagues in private call a membership in the College of the American College of Pretrial Lawyering, can be the end in and of itself. And again, quite frankly, there it is often the case that judges do not significantly rein in what's going on between the lawyers in the course of the pretrial discovery process. Third, technology. When I started practicing law, there was no email. Computers were big things in refrigerated rooms in the basement of engineering schools, and you needed decks of cards to make them do anything. And even for many years until the last decade or so, electronic documents were the tail and not the dog. And now paper discovery is an aside. The vast majority of discovery, as those of you who practice law know, is e-discovery. The volumes are staggering. Virtually every case I'm involved in involves not thousands, not hundreds of thousands, but millions of pages of discovery. There are firms that are making huge amounts of money just doing the plumbing, just processing, not even reading and analyzing, but just processing the bits and bytes that make up these millions and millions of pages of documents. And finally, the fourth factor that I have seen as contributing to this cost is the risk that lawyers face if their clients don't preserve every single bit and byte of what might ultimately be deemed relevant later. And you're, I'm sure, quite familiar, as I am, with cases that have come down around the country that have dealt with the question of what happens when something's missed. Even when it's missed, not because of a deliberate effort to hide something, which obviously is foolhardy, not to mention unethical, but being missed because it was missed. And if you roll these together, the idea that sometimes discovery becomes an end in and of itself, and you end up litigating the appropriateness or inappropriateness of what's done in discovery, and something's missed in the pile of millions and millions of pages, there are great disincentives to do anything other than press the button and print everything out, pull up the trucks, and deliver mountains and mountains of paper to one another. So the combined effect of all of this, if you assume little fact-based pleading, discovery designed to find everything rather than to avoid surprise, the tactical use of discovery, and the proliferation of discoverable materials, is a world in which, for many litigants, the cost of discovery is daunting. There are literally companies, some of my clients involved, European-based companies that are delisting off of the American stock exchanges in some effort, I think a futile effort in the end, because there are too many causes of action other than securities fraud to deal with, but an effort to avoid the litigation maw in the American system and the expense. So lastly, some prescriptive comments, and these are I've amalgamated these from conferences I have attended before many judges in many cities around the country in the federal system, things I have seen and heard judges do and say that have had a positive effect on this spiraling cost problem that the Supreme Court was attempting to address, I believe, in these two cases. First, a trend toward, driven perhaps by these cases, but again, I think it's a calibration and not a cataclysmic change, a trend toward requiring more fact-based pleading. So there really is more substantive knowledge, notice, at the outset of what the other side's case is about. Secondly, I've attended several conferences in the last year or so in which, in the Rule 16 context, the district judges have had the parties in and literally looked the lawyers in the eye and said, tell your adversary what your case is about in simple English, and have had us sit around a conference table, typically in the judges' chambers or in court, and just explain in simple English to our adversaries what our case is about. Third, requirements that you identify who was primarily involved. You know, we all, those of us who practice law, have spent lots of time and perhaps made a lot of money deposing lots of people who have had little or nothing to do with the dispute in question. And sitting the lawyers down at the beginning and saying, tell me who the principal actors were. Who negotiated the contract? Who drafted the contract? Who were the decision makers for the marketing program involved in the antitrust case, if that's what it is? So tell them what your case is about. Tell us who the principal people involved are. Imposing a rule that you cannot use any document at trial that you have not produced, as opposed to hoping the other side poorly drafts a Rule 34 request and you can get away without producing something that you really want to use and justify it later until the intended trial exhibits are exchanged on the ground that it wasn't requested on the other side. Well, I've found more and more judges saying, if you don't produce it, the burden's on you and you can't use it. Fourth, agreeing in advance to the custodians whose files will be searched and the search criteria that will be used to search those files, so that it's not a black box system, but you literally notify your adversary, these are the terms that we intend to use to search all of those electronic files, and if you have a problem with that, speak now, so that the search is done once on an agreed upon set of search terms, we identify for one another who the custodians are, whose files are being searched, and whatever comes out of that process will be exchanged between the parties. And finally, imposing, and this is fairly common these days in my experience, imposing pretty strict limits, in addition to all that I've just listed, on what discovery will take place, with the burden on the lawyers to come in and show good cause for getting additional discovery. So for example, you will take 10 depositions of no more than 7 hours of clock time each. And if you want more than 10 depositions, you're gonna have to come here and persuade me that you're entitled to 11 or 12 or 18. But I'm gonna start in the first instance with only 10 or some suitable number for that size case. And you're going to limit each other to 20 custodians or 30 custodians or 25 custodians whose files are going to be searched. And if you want more, you're going to have to come in and persuade me that you're entitled to more. The combination of those things, in my experience at least, has had a salutary effect on this spiraling expense.
Thank you so much, Evan, for your remarks. The academic plane, and as I said, my colleague Arthur Miller has been at this for a long time, has a great perspective, and look forward to his remarks.
Yes, I've been at this much too long. I think I'm in about my 45th year with that stupid treatise. So I come before you not simply as an academic. In the spirit of full disclosure, it must be confessed that I have a certain plaintiff orientation. I also come before you as an old fogey. And what I'd like to do is put Twombly and Iqbal into an old fogey's perspective. I go back far enough to remember that the conception of the federal rules promulgated in 38 was an easy access philosophy. Very simplified pleadings, generalized pleadings, to be followed by liberal discovery, a limited summary judgment prerogative, all with an eye toward what one might call the gold standard of adjudication, namely trial before a jury. And in those halcyon days, that was a model that seemed to work. And it worked for many, many years. To me, Twombly and Iqbal, to second Eleanor's judgment, does change the landscape if you view the landscape over the history of the federal rules. But Twombly and Iqbal have to be viewed as simply a point on a spectrum. For the last 25 years, to pick up again something Eleanor was driving at, there has been constant increasing pressure toward earlier and earlier determination of actions. And in those 25 years, as Eleanor suggested, the pendulum has basically been against plaintiffs. It's almost as if we no longer know how to try cases or want to try cases. Many judges have limited experience in handling the trials of cases. In 1986, to start the period rolling, the Supreme Court of the United States decided three summary judgment cases. Those three cases took a procedure noted for its limited use and gave it life. Some would say too much life. The most significant of the three, from our perspective, is a case called Matsushita, an antitrust case, in which the court said that on a summary judgment motion, the claim had to be plausible. It had to be plausible. Summary judgment, not surprisingly, became the Twombly of its day. Everybody made summary judgment motions. And the limited empiric evidence we have is that summary judgment grants increased. It certainly loaded that procedure. Virtually every amendment to the discovery rules since 1986 has been an attempt to constrict discovery. I'm an unindicted co-conspirator because I was a reporter to the Federal Rules Advisory Committee, and we pushed through a rule amendment in 83 to eliminate redundant and disproportionate discovery. Since then, as Evan has referred, there have been theoretical limitations, number of depositions, number of interrogatories, please, no semicolons. And most recently, this curious shift from anything relevant to the subject matter of the action to anything relevant to a claim or defense in the action. You get the picture. It's in that environment that you see in 2007 and 2009, Supreme Court of the United States decides to bypass the rulemaking process and in effect legislate about pleading. They want, notice the word du jour, plausibility. They want plausibility pleading. Souter apparently ignoring the fact that the use of the word plausibility in Matsushita dealt with the substantive elements of antitrust cases. Now we've got plausibility in the pleading of antitrust cases, and then watch the bouncing ball. Iqbal says we have to have plausibility in all cases. I can't connect those dots. I just can't. And what else do we learn from Iqbal? The court is to determine plausibility on the basis of its judicial experience and common sense. Judicial experience and common sense. And the court is to look for a more likely innocent explanation. Now, what's that done to the pleadings? Number one, it's reverted the pleading structure to fact pleading, which died in 38 when the rulemakers expressly eliminated the words fact and cause of action from the pleading formula. The old code words were expressly excised because they were troublemakers. We've got fact pleading. Some of you will say, well, we sort of had fact pleading before Twombly, because the judges, not learned like old fogies are, forgot that they were supposed to be doing notice pleading, even though as recently as 2002, 5 years before Twombly, the court decided Swierkiewicz and reminded everybody, hey, we've got notice pleading. Forgive me, Your Worship. But a lot of your colleagues,
I go last.
Your lot of, watch out for that remaining hour. We sort of had fact pleading. So if you look at Twombly as of 2006, it isn't landscape changing. If you look at Twombly in the run of the history, it is landscape changing. Judicial experience and common sense, a more likely innocent explanation. Now, to me, one of the problems with these cases is that they're destabilizing. They have taken a structure of pleading and motion and destabilized them. We've got fact pleading now. And the 12B6 motion, which was a law motion, has the plaintiff stated a claim for relief, which asks a single law question to be based on one document, the complaint, with all allegations of fact to be accepted as true, which was designed to keep cases in court. We now have to recognize that the 12B6 has been converted into something that is both a law motion and a fact motion. Where inside the four corners of the complaint do you find judicial experience, let alone common sense? Where inside the four corners of a complaint do you find the possibility of an innocent explanation? You'd be shot as a pleader if you included it. But now I suggest to you, it is quite possible that you're supposed to negate the more likely innocent explanation you think the defendant is going to advance in order to stave off the 12B6. That's a form of anticipatory pleading banned in the federal courts for over 150 years. Just a lot of destabilization, which worries people. It's subjective. Am I supposed to do research on the good judge's common sense? Is it now part of the 12B6 motion that I've got to probe your judicial experience and common sense? He is the first to say a newly appointed judge has no judicial experience. So we've just got to look at his common sense.
Yeah. Arthur got that line from me.
I did. I gave you credit. Now, Evan has indicated this was not a binary choice, pleadings or trial. Come on. We know nobody goes to trial. The last trial was in the McKinley administration. We know that.
And Arthur, which side were you on in that trial?
Look, I am a confessed old fogey, Evan.
I just agree with you.
One of the damnations of Twombly is the fact that they did not look for other pressure points to deal with cost, extortionate settlement, and abuse. Judge Souter relies on an article by Judge Easterbrook, 1989.
I know.
89, not 69, 89. I give you 20 more years on that. And decries case management as having modest value. To me, there is so much power yet to be harnessed in case management, it was a crime to do it this way. To me, it was a crime not to allow pinpoint discovery on the question of plausibility in Twombly, which is what the plaintiffs asked for in every court they were in. Finally, when the court talks about cost, it only talks about the defendant's costs. They're worried about Cravath, Evan. They're worried about you. They never mention plaintiff's cost. They never mention that what, in effect, they are doing is shifting costs from the defense over to the plaintiffs in terms of what they're now obliged to do, pre-institution investigation. And finally, not a word in either opinion about competing values. Access to justice, I know it's an abstraction. Transparency, oversight of governmental conduct, private enforcement of public policies. Almost all of our regulatory statutes depend in part on private enforcement. If you're going to inhibit private enforcement by heightened pleading and quick and dirty 12B6 motions, then you are impairing the private enforcement of lots of statutes from the Civil Rights Acts, including the employment statutes, to antitrust, to securities, to consumer, to safety, to environment. All of those statutes, or I shouldn't overstate, many of those statutes were enacted by Congress with the assumption that the federal rules of civil procedure, as they were then understood, were still in force. But they're not.
Thank you, Arthur.
Well, Arthur referred to the language from the opinion about experienced judges, and we certainly have one with us. Judge Koeltl has been on the federal bench since 1994, if I'm not mistaken, and look forward to your perspective from the bench. Judge Koeltl.
It's a real pleasure, a privilege to be here and to follow Arthur Miller. I think that Professor Miller has done an extraordinary job of infusing the discussion of the federal rules of civil procedure with enthusiasm and passion and to heighten awareness that when we deal with civil procedure, we're dealing with a set of rules that reflect values. They reflect the values of our system of justice. They reflect values of access. They reflect the values of our society. And there really are competing interests that are at stake here. And I don't know if all of you are aware of it, but Iqbal and Twombly have caused a substantial amount of discussion in academia. They've raised a substantial amount of discussion at the bar, and they are the subject of a lot of research and writing. Let me begin with my own take on trying to put Iqbal and Twombly into a larger structure, and talk a little about the Duke Conference, and then talk specifically about Iqbal and Twombly themselves. Those decisions really have to be understood in the larger context of efforts that have been going on for some time to re-examine the federal rules of civil procedure to assure that the rules themselves are responsive to the requirement of Rule 1 of the federal rules, that the rules be construed and administered to secure the just, speedy, and inexpensive determination of every action and proceeding. As you heard, Justice Souter's decision in Twombly was based in part on his views of discovery abuse, which was in turn based in part on his reading of Judge Easterbrook's 1989 article on discovery abuse, which may be outdated, as some of the more recent research may well indicate. But it's plain that Twombly was motivated by a desire to deal with the expense of litigation by attempting to limit it at its source. Now, at the time that Twombly was issued, there were already rumblings, as there have been over decades, about the issues of cost and expense of litigation and possible discovery abuse. Twombly was in May of 2007. In August of 2008, the American College of Trial Lawyers, or pretrial lawyers, and the Institute for the Advancement of the American Legal System came out with a survey of their members, which concluded that an initial draft said the system of federal civil litigation was broken. That was softened in the final report to say that there were serious problems. But there was enough of an issue that the Standing Committee of Rules and Practice of the Judicial Conference asked the Advisory Committee on Civil Rules to look into this, and the Advisory Committee decided to have a conference at Duke Law School, which will occur on May 10th and 11th next month, in which we are going to look at the entire system of federal civil litigation to determine whether any amendments should be made in the federal rules to carry out the purpose of Rule 1, as well as whether there should be best practices for lawyers and judges, whether there should be changes in judicial education for the way in which judges handle cases, and whether there should be changes in legal education. For example, should lawyers be taught the importance of cooperation? Should lawyers be taught about the effective and inexpensive ways to litigate cases rather than to expand discovery for the purpose of expanding it? The conference will be based on a lot of new empirical research. The Federal Judicial Center has done a survey of closed cases in the final quarter of 2008. The litigation section of the American Bar Association has done a survey of its members. The National Employment Lawyers Association has done a survey. There are surveys of lawyers in states to look at what state practices are, where they differ from the federal rules, and where the lawyers who practice in both federal and state courts think that the state practices are better. There are also going to be panel discussions, and you'll be pleased to hear that the panel discussion on pleadings and dispositive motions will be chaired by Professor Miller. It will also include Judge Newman from the Second Circuit, who wrote the decision for the Court of Appeals in Iqbal. But pleading is only one part of the system of federal civil litigation, and it's only a part of what was really going on in Twombly. I should add a word here The results of the Federal Judicial Center survey showed that in the majority of cases that are litigated in federal court, there are no discovery problems, that the lawyers believe that the amount of discovery that occurs is proportional to the stakes in those cases, that the amount, that the number of depositions that occur in those cases are really not very many. So you have a system in which you have some cases that really do have a lot of discovery, and you have what may well be the majority of cases in which there are not discovery abuses and which there are limited discovery going on. And yet you need a structure of federal civil rules that apply to pleading and discovery, both e-discovery and regular discovery, motions for summary judgment, that is fair and fair across the board and appears to be fair. And you always have to be concerned that as you tinker with one part of the system to deal with a problem or a perceived problem, you're not eliminating something which the users of another part of the system believe is really quite good. I wanted to provide, and then of course, while all of this work was going on, along came Iqbal, which made it clear that Twombly was indeed to be applied across the board. I wanted to provide that background and highlight Duke for a couple of reasons, not only because of the NCAA, but first because I wanted to make it clear that pleading is only part of a much larger tapestry, and second, that the rules makers who are looking into what does Rule 8 say, what is the standard under Rule 8, and how is it applied under Rule 12, are very cognizant of what's going on and are looking at the issue. Now, let me turn specifically to Iqbal and Twombly. First, a caveat at the beginning. I make it a practice not to talk about my cases and not to talk about issues that may come before me. Well, an old friend of mine once told me, as we were discussing old times, he said, you know, after I said, you know, I can't talk about my case, I can't talk about it, she said, you know, you used to be an interesting person. So, what can I say? Well, I think there are some things I can still say. The first issue is, were Iqbal and Twombly correctly decided? Well, you know, from the standpoint of a district court judge, the answer to that question is easy. You probably know the answer to that. Of course they were correctly decided because the Supreme Court told us that's what the rule means. And we follow what the Supreme Court tells us, and we follow what the Court of Appeals tells us. Beyond that, I think I can provide a few more comments. It's not clear that Iqbal and Twombly are revolutionary. Yes, they've incorporated the concept of plausibility, but there certainly is a question about how the courts will interpret plausibility. In Twombly, the Supreme Court, Justice Souter, as you heard, quoted several times from Professor Miller's treatise for the proposition that a complaint has to plead some facts. They cited it to support the proposition that the pleader must indeed state sufficient factual allegations to raise a right to relief above the speculative level. It reminds me a little of Professor Loss, who wrote such a famous treatise on securities law, and he was arguing a case before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, his treatise had come out the other way, and I asked him, well, how did you justify that? And he said, well, I said it was one of the least advised parts of my treatise. Some lawyers who have responded to surveys from the Federal Judicial Center have said that they've been using fact pleading. They didn't understand what the issue really was with respect to notice pleading, because they write a complaint to tell a story. They want to explain what the plaintiff's position really is. They want to explain it to their adversary. They want to explain it to the judge. So has it really affected a sea change? We have to wait and see how the courts interpret it. But it is at least significant that, after all, in Twombly, the district court judge, Judge Lynch, dismissed the complaint based upon the law as it existed, obviously, before the Supreme Court's decision in Twombly. He thought the complaint did not satisfy the Conley against Gibson standard. So when the Supreme Court came along and articulated the way in which it was going to interpret Rule 8, it was doing it in a way which a district court had already considered was, in fact, consistent with the way in which the Supreme Court had really been interpreting Rule 8. Iqbal continued Twombly, obviously, and Professor Miller and I have discussed the phrase from Iqbal that the reviewing court must draw on judicial experience and common sense. And Professor Miller has roundly criticized those phrases. It's not clear to me that those phrases will be the standard that meets the test of time. As Professor Miller said, could the court really have meant that a first-year judge can't decide a Rule 12b6 motion because there's insufficient judicial experience? That phrase in the decision itself was actually a description of how the Supreme Court viewed the Court of Appeals decision in an effort to talk about factual context, factual complexity. And so we'll see what the Supreme Court does in years in the future. Let me say a few words on whether the standards in Iqbal and Twombly have really made a difference. It is very difficult to come up with empirical research because, district court judges used to cite Conley. We can't cite Conley anymore. So while Conley was cited in many, many, many motions to dismiss, now Twombly and Iqbal are cited in the motions to dismiss. Is the result different? Requires very careful analysis to be able to come up with the answer to that question. Some of the research that's being done now is based upon the written decisions of the lower courts, district courts, courts of appeals. But at the district court level, if the district court denies a motion to dismiss, the court will often deny it from the bench. And it'll never show up in a reported decision in Lexis or Westlaw, and certainly not in FedSup, so you'll never see it. So if you analyzed the written decisions of a district court judge, you'd come up with a very skewed view. You'd find, for example, that some district court judges are granting, the majority of these motions, while in fact the majority are being dismissed, but they're being dismissed without a written decision. There is some preliminary research that I'd like to share with you that the administrative office did in civil rights cases. They analyzed simply from the records without looking at the docket sheets, just the statistics. They looked at monthly averages before Twombly, after Iqbal. Civil rights employment cases. The monthly average in the 7 months before Twombly in civil rights employment cases Motions to dismiss were made in 48 cases. Monthly average, 7 months after Iqbal, motions to dismiss made in 44% of the cases. The motions to dismiss went down, not up. Motions granted before Twombly, 17% of the cases. After Twombly, 15% of the cases. Grants went down. Civil rights, other cases, motions to dismiss made 67% of the cases. After Iqbal, made 67% of the cases. Motions granted before Iqbal, 23%. After Iqbal, 24%. Slight uptick. Very hard to draw revolutionary or sea change conclusions. But the statistics are very, very preliminary. These are motions to dismiss. They include both 12B6 motions as well as other motions such as 12B1 motions. That probably shouldn't make a difference, but I give it to you as a caveat. This is also snapshots in time. So you look at a month and you know that some motions are being made and some motions are being granted, but they're not the same. But again, I don't think should make a difference. There's going to be a lot more empirical research done, particularly by the Federal Judicial Center, which actually goes into the cases, goes into the docket sheets, asks such questions as, for example, if a motion to dismiss was it granted with leave to replead? Was it repleted, and did the complaint eventually survive? Let me end by just really reaffirming what Professor Miller has said, which is that the federal rules reflect the kind of federal judicial center we want and the kind of society we want. There are costs to litigation. Yes, there are costs on defendants, and there are costs on the system. To the extent that judges deal with one case, they're not dealing with another case. To the extent that they spend time on an unmeritorious case, they may not be able to spend time on a meritorious case. And there are costs to plaintiffs. I have seen plaintiffs get so involved with litigation, which may not be meritorious, in a way that has not been helpful to the plaintiff. It is important to have access, obviously. It reflects the kind of society that we want. Where the lines are drawn and who draws them, whether it's the rulemakers, whether it's the courts interpreting the rules, whether it's Congress, are matters that are really, really quite profound.
Thank you very much, Justice. Before entertaining questions from the floor, I wanted to give the members of the panel an opportunity to comment on anybody else's talk. Eleanor, did you have something? Yeah, please. Great.
Justice Koeltl has very wisely and rightly said that the federal rules should reflect the kind of society that we want and that justice should be seen to be done as well as be done. I feel from reading all the advance sheets in my field that justice is not done and justice is not seen to be done. Every week in the advance sheets, there are Twombly motions. Many of them are granted, and many of them are fact configurations that would have passed the line before Twombly. For example, in the air cargo case, in which the defendants had been indicted, the magistrate judge recommended to the judge to throw out the case on a Twombly motion, and it wasn't until after the guilty pleas were entered that the judge decided that the case should stay in court. There are many cases like that now, and even within the terms of Twombly, I'm not even contesting whether one should go back to notice pleading, but given Twombly, there is a really big issue about whether and how the judges apply the Twombly, the plausibility criteria. I very much agree with Justice Stevens in Twombly that the contention of a conspiracy in Twombly was not implausible. It seems so clear to me. It was not implausible. In so many of these cases, the conspiracy is not implausible. I think the question is not really implausible versus plausible, but how plausible. And this is where there is a huge margin for judges to exercise their discretion, which is often exercised on the basis of some experience or wisdom rather than rules, and keeping out of court cases that justly should be in court.
Anything else? The proceeding so far, yes? Is that a comment?
One thing that hasn't been mentioned is the fact that in many, many contexts, some of which are public policy contexts, there is what's called an information asymmetry problem. I don't think I would buck a concept, and Evan sort of alluded to it, the hide the ball concept, which I would translate into the pleading context is, if the plaintiff knows something, he or she should be obliged to plead it. I would add to that that litigation should not be a game for the lazy, so that anything that is accessible through public domain sources, the plaintiff should be obliged to get it. How much detail you would insist on in the pleadings is up for grabs. But in so many contexts, and I think Twombly is such a context, you have information asymmetry because all of the relevant information, or a good deal of it, certainly some of the critical elements of information, are in the sole possession of the defendant. And the defendant may be a governmental agency, maybe Mr. Ashcroft or Mr. Mueller, or the defendant may be a major economic enterprise where various elements of discriminatory conduct are well beyond the accessibility of the plaintiff. That is why I said before that the notion that we've got to stop thinking about, gee, if you allow the plaintiff to survive the 12B6, it's Armageddon. It's millions of dollars of discovery imposed on the defendant. It does not have to be that way, and that is why Mr. Richards, who was representing the plaintiffs in the Twombly case, said, look, all we want is a couple of depositions to get some sense as to whether these people agreed at these meetings we know they attended. Again, the image is pinpoint or flashlight discovery. I think something must be done if we are to enforce lots of federal statutes and state statutes that come to the federal courts in diversity cases or by way of supplemental jurisdiction. If we're going to get a proper level of enforcement of these public policies when you have information asymmetry.
Go ahead. There are a lot of proposals out there in this area which try to deal with the issue of information asymmetry, which try to deal with whether there should be fact pleading, and if so, how much fact pleading. Some proposals would say that the plaintiff has to plead a lot of facts, everything that the plaintiff knows in support of the plaintiff's claim should be pleaded, but usually also link that with some proposal either for pre-complaint discovery, such as there are some proposals that say that a prospective plaintiff should be allowed discovery on a showing of probable cause to a judge, so that the judge would have to say, well, yes, you have enough in this case in order to be able to get discovery to see if you can file a complaint. Under the rules as they are now, except with a securities fraud case where you've got special rules that automatically stay discovery, the judge still has the power to let discovery go forward after the complaint is filed, except there is language in Iqbal and Twombly that a motion to dismiss should be decided. And if you don't have enough information to be able to have pleaded your complaint, you don't survive the motion. But there's no automatic stay in discovery, and what courts will do with that is a whole other issue. But there are a lot of proposals out there, and that's why it's so good that Arthur is chairing this panel to try and reach a consensus on what to do with the current state.
Thank you, Jim. Evan?
Just a couple of quick points. The informational asymmetry typically translates into a cost asymmetry. And so, Arthur, I think I would challenge the idea that there is a simple cost shifting from the defense to the plaintiff. There is, to be sure, some cost shifting to the extent that the plaintiff has to know more and presumably learn more in order to survive a motion to dismiss than was the case before, but it's not a symmetrical cost shifting. In so many cases, what you're talking about, when you go back and read the Twombly language carefully, is simply getting enough information into the complaint to satisfy what I have to say again is in my view, not an extraordinary lifting of the bar, a calibration. And I think Judge Koeltl's point that Judge Lynch threw the complaint out in the Twombly case before the Supreme Court decided the Twombly case.
Everybody is forgetting the Court of Appeals reversed.
Right, the Second Circuit didn't get it. I understand. They missed the point. Yeah. But the district judge hadn't missed the point, and the Supreme Court hadn't missed the point. And again, I mean, I've been litigating in the federal district courts for 35 years, 33 of which were before the Twombly case, and saw many district judges dismiss many complaints on the ground that the facts, notwithstanding what Clark thought he was doing in 1938, that the facts were not sufficient to establish a claim as a matter of law as Rule 12 requires.
So, and that my was good happening. Friend, you're hiding behind a bunch of lawless judges.
As I should be.
I mean, we all trust this good gentleman here. But my God, have you seen some of the cases involving the Enron, WorldCom type cases that were thrown out of federal court? It's a reminder of what Eleanor pointed out. Until you indict the son of a bitch, nothing's plausible.
That's a plausibility test. I'd like to open up the floor. There are many very experienced, distinguished lawyers in the room, I know, and they may, I'm sure, have something to add. Yes, sir, in the back.
They did.
Not a very big bar, but fertile, because you're just making plausible discovery determine which ones of them you may be able to prove at that trial? That's my naive question. You probably get shot down, but I just had to ask.
I'd like to ask Professor Fox to address that. I would observe, though, before that Rule 11 was the original tough Rule 11 was supported and drafted by yes, guilty as charged. But Professor Fox,
First of all, yes, you wouldn't allege it unless you had information. But assume you had all of that information. That is exactly what's getting struck down today. It doesn't pass the bar. And the airline agent case is one good case for that, where there were hundreds of meetings between and among the executives, as well as parallel pricing, lockstep pricing. So that's exactly the case.
What about that provision in Rule 8 that you're allowed to plead alternatively, hypothetically, and inconsistently? You square that with Twombly, and I'll sell you the Brooklyn Bridge.
Yes.
Judge Koeltl, one of the things I heard you say about the Federal Judicial Center study was that it seemed to indicate that in most cases there really was the right amount of discovery, which may not be quite squared with what Mr. Chesler was telling us. But does that indicate to you that we should be thinking about no longer having trans-substantive rules, particularly in the pleading area? And of course, we've got the PSLRA in the securities area, which is an example of that, or if you prefer fraud and mistake on Rule 9b, to do that. And there's a second half to that, because if that does seem to be the indication, haven't we already sort of gone through that experiment back in the early 90s when we started to think about tracking and having the complex case that was going to be treated different than the more simple case?
Thank you for the question. I appreciate the question because it's a very important issue. I personally believe that the trans-substantive nature of the federal rules is very valuable. It says that we have a system of justice that treats all parties and all cases the same. Or as Judge Weinfeld, who is so important to this law school, would say, every case is important. Every case is different, every case is interesting, and every case is important. There are no special rules. So the trans-substantive nature of the rules is very important. I don't think that what the Federal Judicial Center has found suggests that we should do away with trans-substantive rules. Rather, to me, it suggests there are things that we can do that deal with what could be seen as excesses or abuses at one end of the spectrum, and it wouldn't affect what we do at the other end of the spectrum. Think about it. The rules that we have now with the limits on the number of depositions and the length of depositions and the like, they don't bite with the majority of cases where the depositions are reasonably conducted and few in number. To the extent that we promote judicial management, some cases just don't require it. And so you keep the trans-substantive nature of the rules by looking at where the abuses are and thinking about the importance of rules that go across the board. I agree with you that when we had the tracking system, when the Southern District had three tracks, complex, regular, and expedited, it was found lawyers didn't like it and it didn't work. And when Rand looked at all of the pilot projects and all of the courts that did pilot programs, they found that tracking didn't help. It didn't promote the just, inexpensive resolution of every case. So I do think that we can make improvements without sacrificing the trans-substantive nature of the rules, though some people are certainly thinking about that.
I'd like to invite, we have a very distinguished visitor at the law school this year with whom I have the pleasure of co-teaching. Professor Rolf Stirner is a member of the University of Freiburg faculty and was one of the co-reporters of the ALI Unidroit transnational rules in commercial cases. I wonder if you could give us some perspective from another very different legal system. Thank you. I'm tempted to say if the Supreme Court knew that it was moving away from the American model, they might have decided something altogether different. You might have gotten Justice Robert, Chief Justice Roberts' vote author on that one. Any reactions to the comparative approach? If you go on the NYU website, did you want to say that? If you go on the NYU Law School website, one of the pictures that pops up if you stay long enough is that of my esteemed colleague, Professor Miller, and he says, the rest of the world may think we're nuts with regard to our civil procedure rules, but we like it that way, or words to that effect. Forgive me if I'm not quoting you properly, Arthur. Other questions or comments? Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
The case is Star against Sony. Second Circuit decided January 13. And it is a case of the producers of music, digital music, in a world where they're reacting against piracy, right, and they want to be sure to charge for the digital music. This is a case in which the district court threw out the case, but the Second Circuit reversed. So, yeah.
As I recall, Second Circuit Judge Robert Katzman wrote that opinion, and I'm proud to say he's a member of the IJA board as well. Other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
It's a very interesting question. And those of you who are here may know more about this than I do, but there is a very significant movement afoot in the United States following on a movement that started in the UK some years ago for third-party financing of litigation. In fact, there are a number of funds that have been raised. Several of the Wall Street banks are contributing to funds. And there is a very, very substantial and, as far as I can tell, growing effort to finance, third-party finance litigation, in which basically the partnerships are formed that acquire the cause of action, they retain counsel, and they enter into agreements which divide the recovery among the investor group, which is it affiliated with the financing group in some way, the original owner of the claim, who's paid some fee for having transferred the claim to the purchasers, and the lawyers who take the case for the investment group. And as I say, it's, apparently there's a lot of that type of third-party financing going on in the UK, and some of the investor groups that have formed the investment pools in the UK are now participating in the investment pools in the United States. Raises a whole lot of very interesting and complicated. It's too bad we don't have Steve Gillers here tonight. He could, I'm sure, speak for quite a long time on these subjects, but I'm not sure there's a cause and effect relationship. I wouldn't hang this on Twombly, because it may well be that it's happening completely separate and apart from Twombly, but it's happening.
Yes, ma'am.
It certainly will depend on the case. Some of the cases, though, you know, arise in a situation where you begin with a wrong. So the plaintiff in the civil rights cases with the police, or the civil rights cases that arise in the prison context, you have individuals that the plaintiffs sue with the knowledge that they were, with the factual support for the complaint that they were injured by specific individuals. They begin a case. Do they have enough evidence at that point, enough facts to plead that the warden was in on it? We don't know at this point. On the other hand, one of the questions to be asked is, those cases often leave open that there are other defendants. There are John Doe defendants. A person may not include a policy or practice as part of the initial complaint. but you take limited discovery, and lo and behold, you can ask questions as to whether individuals were acting pursuant to orders of others, or whether others knew. So the only thing I would say in that area is, you know, you have to look at each case individually. The employment, the plaintiff's employment lawyers, I'm told, say that as a matter of course, they have been pleading facts. I mean, they tell their story. They are concerned, I think, not so much about, frankly, Iqbal and Twombly, as they are about thoughts about limitations on discovery. They think, you know, you can get into court on the basis of your complaint, they would be very concerned to change the system in a way that attempts in some way to place limits on the discovery that that they have. So,
another response to your point is that we talk about Iqbal being dismissed, but it was only dismissed against Attorney General Ashcroft and the FBI director. And to the best of my knowledge, the case continues against the local officials who are alleged to have discriminated. And it's possible, following on Judge Koeltl's point, that discovery from them will lead to an amendment to the complaint, which will have quote-unquote plausibility. One of my colleagues—
It is reported, and I'm not part of that case, I don't know. It's been reported that the case was settled for a substantial amount of money.
I didn't know that. Okay, well, that's interesting. One of my colleagues from the CPLR committee of the New York State Bar Association.
Speaking of which, I was just going to ask,
if I may, I think the answer is yes. It hasn't been worked out yet, and I think it's a very interesting, interesting and important question that some civil procedure teachers might put on their exams next year, as an Erie question. Should the federal court under the Erie case apply the pleading rule of the state when it is quote unquote outcome determinative? And we just had, for those of you who haven't seen it, a case in the Supreme Court of the United States holding that the limitations on class actions in New York, in that New York has in Article 9, should not be applied in a federal case, because under Erie, as you, and its progeny, as you know, the rule is that if there's a federal rule that applies, you apply the federal rule. So maybe that case, I'd be interested to hear Professor Miller on, the Shady Grove case. I'd be interested to hear Professor Miller's view on my little exam question. I hope none of my students are in the room.
It's too simple. I think in a removed case, you're bound by the federal rule. And I would assume, hypothetically, that if you've got a state complaint, let's say out of Arizona, which has thus far indicated it's not crazy about Twombly and Iqbal, that if you pled sufficiently under 8A2, as us old fogies remember it, and then are removed to federal court, you'll be faced with a 12B6. But any rational federal judge would allow you leave to replead.
Well, why don't we thank our panelists. As I look up to Arthur Vanderbilt, who was the founder of the Institute of Judicial Administration, I think he'd be very pleased with the program tonight. So thank you all for attending.